to the Building Bite podcast, a podcast for construction contractors, owners, and insurance professionals, where you hear from the experts on key topics to help you be successful. I'm Valerie Bono, one of the show's hosts and head of marketing and communications at Proactive. And today we are taking a bite out of women in leadership with a focus on insurance. I am here with my co-host, Peter Duggan, President and CEO at Proactive, and our guest, a leading underwriter within the insurance industry, Heather O'Neill. Heather is an AVP of Construction Specialty Products for Arch Insurance Group. Heather, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great, Valerie. Thanks so much. Really appreciate the opportunity to join you and Peter on the podcast today.
Yeah, thank you so much for being with us today. Peter, how are you?
I'm doing wonderfully, and I'm so excited. You know, women in leadership has been one of my favorite topics to address on the podcast, and I think Heather's going to knock it out of the park. So Heather, tell us a little bit what brought you onto the show.
Yeah, so I was really excited to visit with you guys and kind of in preparing for today and thinking about my career progression and sort of how I've ended up in a leadership role really forced me to take a look back at all the stops I've made along the way. And I think one of the things that sticks out to me is how important relationship building is and really finding people in those places to kind of mentor you and finding people who take a vested interest in your career development. And I think you'll hear a lot as we're talking today about some of those folks who have helped influence me and kind of guide me along the way. I think it'll be sort of a theme as we're visiting. We can't get there on our own, right?
So well said.
So Heather, I'm really thankful to collaborate with you on this episode and join you on the topic's journey of growing into a leadership role as a female in the insurance industry. And you've had quite the journey in your insurance career. So can you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you chose insurance?
Yes, absolutely. I grew up actually in the Wichita, Kansas area, and as a young child running around in wheat fields, I was always really interested in insurance, kind of chose to study it in my career. Peter's laughing. I was making sure Peter was listening. Of course, that's just joking. Like so many people in this industry, I kind of fell into it by accident, but really ended up stumbling onto a great career. Growing up in Kansas, moved down to Texas to go to college at Texas Christian University over in Fort Worth. Ended up pursuing a liberal arts degree, graduated from TCU in 2004. I studied history and English. And just to kind of make a little bit of plug for the folks out there who study liberal arts, I think for people like me, I would not have, insurance was not even on my radar. But there's so many things you learn in pursuing liberal arts. Mainly, I think, writing a ton of essays, right? So you're kind of learning critical thinking, but being able to assimilate a lot of different information and different data points. So an example of that, you know, studying history, looking at Irish history, understanding the conflict that was going on in that country kind of informed the way I read James Joyce or William Butler Yeats in some of my literature classes. So I think being able to see a broader picture and pull together different information can be really valuable, especially in an underwriting setting where you're trying to understand sort of a larger story and a complex risk.
Yeah. And Heather, after finishing your liberal arts degree, you took your first job. Tell us about that.
Yes. So I really thought that I would stay in the academic realm, but that just didn't pan out. And I had these really cool things called student loans that come due about 6 months after you graduate. So I figured I really needed to find a job. And I became aware of an executive assistant position and opening at a company called ACIG, which is American Contractors Insurance Group. It's a captive insurer for general contractors. Of course, I had no idea what that meant at the time, but I thought all of that sounded really interesting and a good place to start. I joke that ACIG is the place that I learned to spell insurance because part of the hiring practice, and I think they've done away with this now, thank goodness, was actually administering a spelling test where you were recognizing in a list of words which ones were misspelled, and insurance was one of them. So I was really glad I passed the test and was able to join ACAG as an executive assistant in the beginning of 2005.
Excellent. And after you started that, you ultimately turned that into a career. Tell us a little bit about how you transitioned from making that a job to extending that into a career.
Yes. And circling back to kind of the earlier point at the beginning, the people that you work with and the relationships you build become so important. And I was really fortunate to support James Shea as one of the folks I supported in the executive assistant position. He was just actually, James and I started at ACAG on the same day. He was making a big move, transitioning from being the risk manager at Swinerton on the West Coast to moving to Dallas with his family. So he and I were sort of figuring out the company culture and dynamics together, which was super fun. But the thing that was great about James and why I even bring this up is he was one of the people in my career who kind of recognized that I was capable of a little bit more and gave me opportunities to learn about insurance. And some of that, you know, for folks listening, and insurance is like learning a different language. I mean, there's so much terminology. And he gave me the opportunity to sit into meetings. And I think some of that was learning through osmosis and hearing what other people were saying. But he also gave me real opportunities through projects and things to learn more. But one of the funny stories that sticks out to me is one day I was sitting at my desk and James came by and said, "Hey, Heather, do some research on railroad protective coverage and send it to one of the risk managers of the general contractors we worked with." And I, again, didn't know anything about what he was saying, but I'm a naturally really curious person. And so that just made me want to learn more. And I took that opportunity to do research, which helped me kind of grow my knowledge of insurance. But the other opportunity that he was really giving me there was to present myself as a resource to a shareholder, you know, to actually promote myself externally through being the person to send the email with the information. And I think that's something I'm always working on and is not always natural for females in business. So I did appreciate that lesson early on. And I think too, it's just a primer, you know, he was setting me up to take that next step in my career. So after being at ACAG for a couple of years and looking for the next step, I was well positioned and the folks at ACAG were supportive of me taking that next step and moving into an account manager position, which I'm very grateful for. That position was a lot more client-facing, so I was interacting a lot more with the shareholders. Really got to learn about a lot about insurance and also building the relationship piece. ACAG as a captive, that unique structure, you know, the customers you're working with are your shareholders. So there's a high level, an expectation around accountability and response time. At the time I was working there, and I don't know that this has changed, but there was a 24-hour response time expectation for getting back to the shareholders. So I really learned through all of that. You've really got to do what you say you're going to do and be responsive. And that helps build trust with the folks you're working with so that they see you as a valuable resource.
That's wonderful, Heather. I love hearing that journey earlier on in your career and also hearing about the champions who have helped support you get to where you are today.
Yes.
We know we talked about ACIG not just being a carrier, but they also have an agency arm and how working with an outside carrier helped influence you. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yes. So ACAG, obviously there's the captive insurance piece, but they do have an agency arm that helps place outside lines for the shareholders. And some of that included professional. And then also this really unique product that I was interested in called SubGuard at the time with Zurich. So we got to interact a lot with some of the external carriers. At the time, ACAG had a partnership with Zurich. So I got to see a lot of those underwriters. Zurich was actually in the 14th floor of our building. We were in the 16th floor. And I think getting some interest in what it actually took to place outside lines and also hearing from the underwriters kind of primed me for some of the moves I would make later. But one of the important relationships I built at the time was with one of the underwriters at Zurich named Amelia Valls, who was supporting professional and subguard. She came up to our office, and I joke with her now that I thought that she was like 6 foot tall. I thought she was a really tall person. She just had such presence in a room. She's only 5'2" for people who know her. But I was always really impressed with her ability to hold her own in a room that, you know, in our industry tends to be primarily male, and really present herself as a subject matter expert. So it was fun to get to know her professionally, but we also became personal friends, and that became a really influential relationship as my career developed.
Like any good English major, you're foreshadowing future into your career.
Yes.
I love it.
Exactly.
Okay. So, you know, as you talk about ACIG, it's obviously you have very fond memories. You had a champion, you had some career growth there, but you, I think, wanted to look at a couple of other things. I think next you went to the broker side, right? Tell us about that.
Some of that getting exposure to the outside lines really did. It was interesting to me, and I wanted to learn a little bit more about what was out there and kind of expand my knowledge around different insurance products. And also, what does it take to really place a complex insurance program and get involved on the broker side? And like you said, I had a lot of support at ACIG. James didn't speak to me for a little bit after I left, but we're still really good friends today. But I became aware of a local agency here in Dallas called Roach Howard Smith & Barton. Roach Howard was super reputable in this local area. I got to know a few of the people there and eventually got the opportunity to join that team as a commercial lines account manager in late December. So it was December 2009. And I will say, you guys knowing what the world looked like in December 2009, I mean, we were right in the middle of the recession. I'm actually really fortunate I was even able to make a job change at that time. But it was really interesting. I was a young person and kind of understanding market cycles. You know, the market kind of went from a soft market to a hard market overnight as some of those carriers lost investment income and kind of needing to make some things up through rate. So that was a really, there was a little bit of trial by fire to some extent and figuring all of those things out. And the other thing to kind of hit on with Roach Howard, I was really intrigued to go over there because at the time it was female run. Karen Ferris was the president at the time, and she had a really good reputation in the Dallas area. She had been with the agency a long time and was really integral to building the agency in a profitable way, so actually growing it, which for folks who understand this is so important for independent agencies that want to remain independent. And Karen was also, just like I was impressed with Amelia being a subject matter expert, Karen was such a powerhouse in the technology space. I was really intimidated by her in coming over. I think those are fun people to surround yourself with because it sort of forces you to up your game. I definitely didn't want to disappoint her anytime I was working with her. Over time, we built a great working relationship, but it was fun to have her as sort of an influential figure as I was developing on the broker side.
Heather, what kind of challenges did you face when you were on the broker side?
I feel like moving over to the broker side, and this is with any change that people make, I feel like you don't know what you don't know until you get there. And fortunately, I had a lot of good people around me, including Paula Walters, who was my senior account manager, really helping me figure out kind of getting the lay of the land. But Roach Howard supported insurance programs for all sorts of industries, technology companies, and law firms and shipping and logistics and public entities. And each one of those industries has unique risk profiles and unique needs. So really understanding, I mean, for me, it was a great chance to expand my knowledge base just around insurance in general. You know, why is D&O so important for a startup tech company? how is professional coverage for an architect different than professional coverage for a law firm? Why is cargo so important for shipping and logistics companies, which it really, really is? But there was so much to learn, and I'm so grateful for that opportunity because I think it just really broadened my understanding of insurance in general.
Wow, that sounds like a wonderful opportunity to broaden what you know about the insurance industry. And I know the last time we spoke, Heather, you mentioned at one point you actually left insurance, correct?
I did. And I will borrow a term from a video blog person that my husband and I follow, which is he talks about the Tarzan approach, which is sort of swinging from branch to branch. And he talks about how to somebody looking in from the outside, it may not look like you're going anywhere. But I think each of those swings that I've made in my career, having purpose with the changes I've made, the swing from branch to branch has actually added something to my skill set that has gotten me to the place I'm at today. Long way to answer your question. But yes, after being in the insurance space for 8 years, I thought that I wanted to make. So in 2013, I did make a transition to working in nonprofit. And my husband and I are really passionate about giving back to the community, and nonprofit work is important to us. And I thought I kind of wanted to give that a shot and maybe give back in a more concrete way. So I got the opportunity to work at the Nature Conservancy. One of my good friends at TCU was working there and made me aware of a position to support fundraising efforts for the Texas chapter. I think what was really cool about that was getting to sort of see behind the curtain of nonprofit and how challenging it really is to fund for such important work and getting people really engaged in the mission. But one of the things I think that sticks out the most about my experience there, so that actually was another place that happened to be female run. Laura Huffman was running the Texas chapter of the Nature Conservancy at the time. And she's a person who kind of has a background in politics, and she's got a great personality, is very charismatic. But she sort of had three tenets that she talked about. And the first one was assume good intent with the people that you're working with, both internally and externally. I think that just fosters a great environment of respect. And then also every role matters. So in the organization, whether you're the scientist in the field doing the research or you're an assistant in the office, that everyone had something to contribute to the mission. Again, I think that there's that also fosters some respect. And then the third one, which I think I've taken to many places I've been, is think big. So it was just sort of a challenge for people to think outside of the box and really consider how can we expand our work? How can we maybe engage different people in the community? And that's such an important thing too. And I've taken that forward even at my underwriting position here at Arch as we're trying to continually evolve to think big. But ultimately, I did find myself being pulled back into insurance. I did kind of miss what I had going on in the trajectory of my career. And I was really fortunate that at that time, my family at Roach Howard welcomed me back, which was so nice. And I think I also figured out that I can still give back on a personal level. I've actually been a part of the advisory council for a group here called United to Learn, which supports underserved elementary schools in Dallas Independent School District. And they're doing really important work. I'm making a little bit of a plug for United to Learn. If anybody wants to know more about them, please reach out.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Heather, speaking of thinking big, you know, a lot of people tell us, oh, I fell into insurance, or, oh, I just landed up there. You, very differently, chose it not once, but twice. And now it's stuck, right? Now it's stuck. So tell us, what is it about insurance, and it sounds like underwriting, that really made insurance stick for you?
Insurance is like the mob, Peter. It just keeps pulling you back in. I think it's a really great question because, you know, when you talk to family and friends about insurance, I think there's just huge misconceptions about the industry. And a lot of people think that you're talking about homeowners or health insurance and not really understanding the more complex landscape and what careers there really are out there. I had a friend say to me one time, insurance is boring. And I just kind of, I just kind of laughed because I'm like, my job can be a lot of things. challenging in a million different ways, but I've never found it to be boring. And so I think for people, you know, what sort of pulled me back into the industry and things I ask of people considering it as a career or maybe even not knowing about it is, do you like problem solving? Do you like critical thinking? Do you like relationship building? This might be a great career for you. And I think it's exciting right now, especially in the construction space when there's always emerging risks, to sort of come up with different ways to do things.
Yeah, Heather, for our listeners, if they're unfamiliar with the types of problems that you're solving, could you give them an example of one?
Yes. Well, so where I'm currently at Arch, you know, we've spent a lot of time, I think the problems to solve sometimes are just pain points or people maybe asking you to kind of think outside the box and do something differently. And we've been taking a poll over the last year with customers and brokers to say, hey, what are some things that we can do better for you? So I think without getting too specific with an example, you know, earlier in the year, I did work with a customer on a renewal, which was business that I think with the changing landscape, we could have lost. But I think really engaging, listening to the customer and understanding what's important to you. How can I actually tailor a coverage to your business? And I think so much of that, and we'll talk about this later, is taking the time to really understand your customer's business and listening to what's important to them. SDI that I support now is a non-admitted coverage. It's on surplus lines paper. So we have a lot of flexibility to manuscript things. I like the creativity and engaging that liberal arts background to actually try to tailor some solutions for our customers.
Yeah, I love that. And I love your analogy comparing insurance to the mob. So you found yourself being sucked back in, right? So can you talk a little bit more about your transition from underwriting and then that moment that you really started specializing more in SDI?
So like I said, in February 2014, made the transition back to insurance and was really lucky to be welcomed back by the Roach Howard team. So that was in February. And then in the summer, I got a call from my old friend, Amelia Valls. And Amelia had made the transition from working at Zurich to working at Excel, which is now AXA Excel. And she was one of the first people on that team to build out a new SDI program offering. And I had been following what she was doing and was pretty interested by it. And she reached out to me and said, hey, we have a couple of underwriting positions open on our team. Would you be interested? And I said, I would absolutely be interested, but I don't have underwriting experience. And she said, I know. And I said, Amelia, I don't have underwriting experience. And she said, I know. And so she kind of proceeded to explain to me how they were trying to build out the team and really bringing people on board that would be a cultural fit with the team and had the right soft skills and focus on relationship building with kind of the right smarts to be able to pick up the product piece behind the scenes. So I thought that was a really interesting approach. And I was very interested, but super apprehensive also. You know, I had just come back to Roach Howard. And so it was kind of a big career decision to make at that time. And I kind of, so side story, I remembered something that happened in high school. When I was a sophomore, I decided to try out for cross country for the first time. And my dad drove me to that first tryout. And I looked out the window at all of the kids I hadn't met who seemed to all know each other and seemed very fit. And I was really intimidated. And I turned to my dad and I said, I was just joking. I don't actually want to do cross country. We can go home. You know, I changed my mind. And my dad, being my dad, turned to me and said, that's great. Get out of the car. And he really just said, hey, you've got to try it. If it's not for you, you can do something different, but give it a chance. And I did end up enjoying cross country. So I've tried to keep that in mind anytime I'm being faced with kind of a difficult decision or something where maybe I'm a little, have the tendency to stay in my comfort zone, but to actually get out there and kind of take a risk. So ultimately, I did call Amelia back and joined the SDI underwriting team at Excel, which was, I mean, has just put me on such a trajectory, and I'm so grateful for the opportunity. But I think also one of the things, you know, I'd spent this time at Roche Howard kind of broadening my knowledge base. And this was kind of a cool opportunity to go back in a little bit and take my knowledge of a particular product a little deeper. So become that kind of inch wide, mile deep, and actually becoming a subject matter expert in something was really intriguing to me. At the time that I joined Excel, they had their track shoes on. I mean, they were really looking to build a new program, and it was exciting to learn from people like Amelia and Jason LaMonica and Megan Fletcher, who were all really passionate about finding different ways to do things. So that the other interesting piece, I started at Excel, Cyrus Manekshaw and I started roughly around the same time. And within a couple months of joining the team, three underwriters and one UA went out on maternity leave. So Cyrus and I kind of looked at each other and we're like, hey, we got to figure out how to be underwriters. This is our thing now. And so it was a little bit of trial by fire again, but I think that that is where you learn so much. And I will say, out of that experience and having to pick up a lot really quickly, I mean, we just really learned in such an expedited manner. It was difficult at the time, but I would not have changed that experience for anything.
Now that you've been in SDI for a while, I guess the question I would ask is, what is it? What is the piece of SDI that gets you most energized? Because you exude energy. Anybody who's watching this is going to see how much energy and passion you have for this space. What's the part that's most energizing?
So I have two answers for you. And I think maybe the first one that gets me really energized is the relationship piece of the business. I'm really passionate, like I said, about getting to know our customers. I mean, the biggest compliment that I could get coming out of a meeting is, hey, Heather really got it, or she was really trying to understand us. I think it's such an important piece of building trust, and SDI is really intended to be a long-term partnership. So I really do get energized by that piece of it. And we're very privileged in the SDI space to spend a lot of face-to-face time with our SDI clients. I think that's not typical of every line, but it's so fun. You know, you get to know people, obviously you're getting to know their business, but also just getting to know people personally. And over time, you know, hearing how their kids are doing and watching people grow up and things is an exciting piece. And then, like I said earlier, SDI is unique in that it's on surplus lines paper. So what really energizes me is being in a space where you get to be creative and have the flexibility to kind of innovate on different coverage offerings and kind of thinking outside the box. SDI right now, there are more carriers than there have ever been supporting the product. And I think that keeps us all on our toes, right? We're all challenged right now to come up with different ways to do things and also figure out how to create tailored programs that are best meet the needs of our clients. So those are a couple of things that I think stick out for me in terms of energizing me.
Wonderful. And now, of course, you're at Arch. You had left AXA XL and went over to Arch, and you're bringing this creativity and this energy. Tell us a little bit about the Arch team and what you're working on there.
Yes, I'm super excited to talk about that. I've actually been part of the team here at Arch. I think I'm at 11 months, like today. So I joined in June of 2020. And that was after being at AXA XL and being very comfortable with my team there. I have nothing but respect for those folks. I got the opportunity, once again, got a phone call from my old friend, Amelia Valls. Amelia had left our team at Excel and spent a couple years on the broker side with Willis, which gave her some really unique insight into just kind of overall what was going on in the market. And then she joined Arch in January 2020 to lead the SDI team. So I was really excited about the chance to work with her again. But I also will say there's a very short list of people who could have called me during a global pandemic to make a job change, and I would have actually entertained it. Amelia is one of those people. But I was also really interested in Arch as a company. I'd heard really good things about the culture. Arch is just, it's a specialty underwriting company. I think that makes it a really nice fit for SDI because SDI is not an off-the-shelf product. It's very niche. You know, it requires some outside the box thinking, and Arch as a company really understands that. So when you take Zurich out of the equation for SubGuard, Arch is actually the longest standing carrier in the SDI space. So they've really supported it and understood the product for a long time. And I thought that was pretty interesting. So Amelia, after being at Arch for about 5 months, lost a couple of team members. So she had the opportunity to sort of build out a new team. And I think similarly to building out our team originally at XL, culture was hugely important to her and bringing on the right people with kind of the right mindset. But they don't grow SDI underwriters on trees. So looking for some folks with experience. And she brought myself and Ann Church over. So Ann is our West Coast underwriter. She's in Portland. And then also eventually Jen Hildebrand, who is in Kansas City. And we all work together at AXA XL. So we kind of have a good working relationship. I think what's cool about being able to set the culture up front, we kind of know each other's strengths. We're all really different. But the thing we have in common is that we're all really curious and interested in doing things better. So it's kind of fun to be able to work with a group of people that you trust. We have the same amount of accountability and passion for what we do. And to be challenged on a day-to-day basis by these other women, it's a pretty fun environment. And just kind of bringing our authentic selves to the table too, I think it really resonates with some of the builders we work with. And like I said, we've really spent this last year trying to figure out how can we, A, trying to refine strategy for the future, but how can we kind of continually evolve and grow with our customers and continue to offer solutions to some of their challenges and risks. Also, just hitting on, you know, kind of the theme of this podcast too, in terms of women in leadership, this was really a great opportunity for me to take a more active leadership role as an AVP. And I think that's also the benefit of kind of being on a smaller team is actually kind of having more input on the strategy going forward into the future. So that's been really fun. And I'm excited to see where we can kind of take this. We're a year in, and I think we've made a lot of progress. Having a whole new team, but also being part of a company that's supported the product for a long time. It's kind of a startup that's not a startup. So that's exciting. And we definitely have support of just the folks within the construction group to take this where we want to take it.
Wow, that's incredible. And it's also inspiring to hear that there's this dynamic team of strong female leaders, right? Leading the charge and paving the way for future women leaders as well. So I applaud Art. That's incredible.
I know. I didn't want to be overly effusive, but that's a really strong group of women that I'm challenged by on a daily basis that I trust a lot. And they're real professionals. I mean, the other thing is, we all have dedicated product experience. So we're bringing years of kind of product knowledge to the table, also the benefit of having worked together. I just think there's a lot that we're going to be able to get done. So it's exciting.
Absolutely. That is so exciting. And I love this analogy. We've talked about underwriting being both an art and a science. Can you expand on that and what you found in meeting with contractors?
Yes. So I'm pretty confident that my job will not be outsourced by robots anytime soon. I think there's still a little bit of that feeling people out in an underwriting process, but there's definitely, I think, the left brain side of underwriting, which is very concrete. You know, I could tell you what our appetite is, what kind of builders we like to work with, what market sectors, what a typical program looks like, what we want to see from processes. And all of those things are data points that we evaluate in considering a new customer. But I think the other thing that we're really trying to suss out through the deep dive underwriting process is behavior. And you can send me a document with your processes around pre-qual and quality, but I'm also trying to understand, is this a living, breathing thing? Is this actually a process that's embraced by the culture and the leadership of your company? And I also think, just as my team and me personally is interested in continually improving and learning, that's also an attribute that makes a good SDI partner. So I kind of get excited when I'm in a meeting and I see someone write down something I said, which is not because I think I just say amazing things all the time, but it does show me that the person I'm meeting with is engaged and they want to learn something new. And so it's kind of, there's a little bit of that just feeling people out and kind of the soft skill part and figuring out if the people that we're meeting with are going to be long-term good partners from a cultural standpoint. And it really goes both ways. I mean, they're feeling me out too to see, do I have something to add? Am I going to be a resource? Because we are looking for long-term partners.
No, absolutely. That's really interesting. And you mentioned Amelia and your current team. Are there any other strong leaders that you found yourself gravitating towards in your career?
Yes. So I have actually a couple examples, a career example, and I have a personal example. So my personal example of leaders, people who have really impacted me, I think the person who had a huge impact on my life growing up was my grandpa on my mom's side. My grandpa had his first heart attack when he was 39, like out hunting in a field somewhere. So we're lucky we got him for so long. But he would always say, don't sweat the small stuff, which is, of course, something I try to remember when I'm feeling myself getting overwhelmed. But the thing he was most known for saying in our family is, no one can make you think, act, feel, or believe in any way you don't want to, which is kind of the ultimate, I know, it's the ultimate personal responsibility mantra. I liked to say that back to him when he was like getting frustrated in traffic, being just kind of a bratty kid. But, you know, it can be annoying sometimes, but it's so empowering to take responsibility for your choices because it means you can make different ones. And then from a professional standpoint, I've talked about many people, you know, as we've been going through the podcast, but another person that sticks out is one of my former colleagues at Roach Howard, Stacey Miller. Stacey is one of those people who is such a great example for female leaders, and she's personally so interested in continually improving and learning. So as a single mom, she went back to complete her degree in her 40s, went on to get a master's in professional coaching. She's since taken her skills to another agency here locally, MHBT, which was acquired by Marsh, and really helped build out some business in their West Texas region. And I know she's hugely inspirational for training some of the new producers. So she's definitely, you know, you have a list of kind of people you call for advice and to kind of ground you. And Stacey is definitely one of those, and certainly a person to emulate in terms of promoting herself as a female in the industry. And she definitely didn't shy away from asking for opportunities, which I really admire.
Heather, you mentioned you like to see people write things down. So you can't see my tablet right now, but it says, nobody can make you feel, act, think, or believe in any way that you don't want to. That is a fabulous quote. Is your grandfather still with us?
No, he passed in 2015, and he was just a couple of days shy of his 80th birthday, which for somebody who had been through the health issues he did was a real blessing. I mean, just a very strong human, never complained.
Wow. Wow. I wish you would have met my grandmother.
Yeah.
Similar level of strength. That is just a fabulous quote. I'm taking that with me.
Okay.
As we move into the next phase of the podcast, we like to give the audience a couple of takeaways. And I've already gotten a bunch. But if we distilled those down to three or four takeaways for the audience, what do you think those would be?
So the first takeaway I hope people hear is to find those trusted mentor folks in your life, people that who will really give you open and honest feedback and also who have a vested interest in you and your development. I think that along the way, I've been really fortunate to have more than one of those people. And it's, you know, when you are kind of making difficult life decisions, I mean, there are still three or four people that I make a call to. But ultimately, you're the person who has to live with the decision. And I think kind of segueing into another takeaway is not being afraid to take a risk, but that has to be your decision. And I think the Tarzan approach has worked for me, but I think it's worked because I've had strong purpose behind each of the moves that I've made. And that kind of takes things, I think when you have some purpose, it takes away that fear of failure and really gives you just an opportunity to learn, which I think is kind of what life is all about. And then from a women in leadership kind of perspective, a lesson that I've learned out throughout my career is just kind of balancing. You know, I come from the Midwest, so I have a tendency to I want to put my head down and work hard. And I think those things will be noticed. And those things are, but I think there's also a balance of getting yourself doing all of those things, but also getting yourself out there and creating some opportunities for visibility. You will have people advocate for you and give you those opportunities, but go out there and get them. If you see a spot to participate in a project or to add value somewhere, get yourself out there. And also don't be afraid to ask for that next step in your development. So being clear about where you want to go, but I think also just working with the people that you report to and actually asking for opportunities and making it clear to them where you're trying to go. Those are my three takeaways.
Heather, if you had to give our audience one action item to take away after this call, what would that be?
Call someone that you trust and ask them for honest feedback. And maybe that person does become sort of a mentor or advocate for you. I think it's important to have a safe space to receive not only positive feedback, but also maybe those opportunities for improvement feedback. And who it is matters. I remember growing up, my mom was an assistant golf pro, and she tried to teach me to golf. And that was like not a good combination of personalities. I got really frustrated about it. But if someone else who wasn't my mom helped give me some feedback about improving my swing or keeping my eye on the ball, I was much more open to it. So I do think it matters sometimes who's providing you the feedback. So find someone that you're open with. It's always good to improve. And I think we all want to try to do that.
No, absolutely. So out of everybody that knows you, right, the trusted mentors, the people you're closest to professionally and personally, what would those people be surprised to hear about you?
I think some of those people do know this, but maybe a surprise for some others is that I do enjoy creative writing as a hobby. I kind of focused on that at the end of my career at TCU. And so writing short stories is kind of a fun outlet. I think I get inspired by being out in the real world. So my writing has taken a little bit of backseat during COVID times, but it is something fun that I enjoy. People may not know that.
And I think anyone that's listening to the podcast would have caught the various stories that you brought through. So I think they would not be surprised, and they may hit you up and say, hey, send me some of those stories so that your secret is out.
Yes.
As we begin to wrap this up, we've got a couple rapid fire questions for you, and they center around the topic of women in leadership. I think the first one is, what do you think is the most significant barrier to female leadership?
I think with any diversity and inclusion challenge, I think representation really matters. So having people that look like you in leadership positions, whether that's a female or a person of color, having someone to aspire to does matter. And I think it's really nice to see Arch and other companies take a really focused approach to diversity and inclusion and considering that in hiring practices. I also think just what I've seen over time, allowing for a flexible work environment does allow more women to rise up in the ranks. I think when you kind of have an old school, everybody's got to be in the office every day and there's not really any flexibility there. It still is the case, I think, with a lot of women that they're the ones running the errands or taking the kids here and there. And if they have the flexibility to do some of those things, they are allowed to continue developing in their career. And I think companies miss some opportunities to have really strong women when they don't allow for some flexibility.
I love that. I got one for you. Okay, so what gets you most excited about work these days?
I think just what I kind of talked about earlier, I think the exciting thing is working with the team that I'm on now and kind of continually finding ways to evolve what we're doing and figuring out ways to do things better. And I think with the small team that we're on, we have a lot of flexibility and can be pretty nimble. So I think just figuring out how we can continue to develop and be a real resource for our customers is exciting.
Heather, what's the greatest risk you've taken as a professional in your entire career?
Well, so I think that we've talked about some of the actual career change risks. But just kind of a funny story that was maybe not risky, but kind of put me right up against my comfort level for risk was taking the external hoist to the roof of the Comcast 2 tower in Philly. One of our contractors at AXA was building that. I mean, it's in the news, so you'll know who they are. But working with risk engineers in this space, they absolutely love to go to the roof. I don't know why. I don't love heights. I will say, I also don't love hoists. They're loud and just kind of sound scary. So I'm always standing like directly in the middle of the hoist and trying not to move too much. So I did, anyway, that was definitely an experience. I mean, I was kind of panicking just halfway up, but I did make it. One of the pre-qual managers that we were traveling with at the time was very kind and quickly got me a bottle of water when we got to the top. But, you know, I don't know how much I'll be doing that. But honestly, when you go to project sites, you just kind of roll with it. And the contractors you're working with do that all the time. So I kind of just have to put my tough face on and not act like an underwriter for a little bit.
Mental note, when you come back for a future podcast, we will not do it on an external hoist. Deal?
Yes, deal. That would be hilarious though. But yeah, we've got a deal.
You may have noticed, Heather, the podcast is called The Building Byte. And Byte stands for BIM, insurance, technology, and the experts like yourself. What are you going to be taking a bite out of today as we bump up against lunch?
The thing I take a bite out of the most in my life are tacos. Texas is really known for its barbecue, but I mean, Tex-Mex is incredible, but in specifically taco places. And within a mile of my house, I've got two: Velvet Taco, which is a really good local Dallas spot, and then Torchy's, which has kind of expanded its footprint a little bit. I think y'all might have a Torchy's in the Raleigh-Durham area. So I will get you information on that. But tacos and queso, if you don't come to Texas and have one of those, you're kind of missing an opportunity.
I'll be on the lookout. I'll have to look that place up. I myself am a taco fan as well. Well, Heather, thank you so much for chatting with us today. If listeners want to hook up with you, where can they find you?
Yeah, so I'm happy to share my email address, you know, for anyone who's interested in reaching out. I'm on LinkedIn, so find me there. Send me a message. Always happy to connect with anyone who wants to kind of talk about career progression stuff or leadership. Or if you have any SDI specific questions or needs, I'm always happy to be a resource.
Thank you.
Appreciate you guys. This was fun.
Thanks, Heather.
Thank you for listening to The Building Byte. This podcast has been brought to you by Proactive. Check us out on thebuildingbyte.com, where you can subscribe to our newsletter and follow us on social media for all future The Building Byte news and updates. You can also find us on your favorite apps, including Apple and Google Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, TuneIn, and Amazon. If you have ideas for episode topics that we should cover on the show, or you know somebody who would be a perfect guest, let us know at connect@thebuildingbyte.com.